All right, so in this video, I'd like to do limits at infinity and in one instance, negative infinity for rational functions. Remember that a rational function is any function that takes the form of a fraction like this, p of x over q of x, where thus p and q functions are both polynomials. So over here, I have some examples. These examples are pretty randomly selected, but they're all rational functions. And they represent three different classes. The first is one where the numerator's degree, which remember the degree is the highest power of x appears in that polynomial. The numerator's degree is larger than the denominator's degree. In the second example down here, the degrees are equal. And then in the third example, the denominator is the one with the larger degree. So that's the distinction we're gonna focus on here. So now I wanna show you a more rigorous approach to determining end behavior or limits at infinity for rational functions. This will be more rigorous than what you learned in pre-calculus because you probably have studied this before. But here's how we can do it. First of all, right off the bat, you might think that we should apply a limit law and split the limit over the division. But let me show you what happens if we attempt to do that. So we'll do the limit of the numerator, the limit of the denominator. Problem is, this is numerator's approaching infinity and the denominator is also approaching infinity. Okay, we have a problem here because this is indeterminate. Just like zero over zero, infinity divided by infinity is also indeterminate. So this entire approach is not going to work. We'll say, read x through that, that doesn't work. Here's something we can do instead. Just like before when we encountered indeterminate forms, an indeterminate situation, we're gonna apply some algebraic manipulation. So let's take this entire numerator and this entire denominator, and we're gonna multiply each of them by something. Now, we're gonna multiply each of them by the reciprocal of a power of x, and you have to choose which power. And it turns out the best way to do this, my opinion, is to multiply by the reciprocal of the highest power of x that appears in the denominator. That would be this, x to the power 1. So I'm going to multiply by 1 over x, 1 over x, in both numerator and denominator. Now, the next step is going to be to distribute that multiplication across each polynomial, like so. Let's see what we get. When we multiply 1 over x by one of the terms in each polynomial, if there's any x powers in that term, one of those powers of x is going to cancel out, right? So like when I multiply x squared by 1 over x, I'm going to get x. You write my limit, and now I'll make a fraction. And so for the first term there, I'll just have x. Then in the second term, that x will cancel with the one in the denominator. We'll just get 1. And for the third term, we don't have any x's, so we just have 1 over x. Now in the denominator, we're going to get 2x times 1 over x. The x's will cancel and we'll just have 2. And then we'll have 3 divided by x. All right, so now we can split the limit up across everything. We're going to take the limit of each part individually. So I'm going to carry this on right down here. I'm going to write it out this long way first. But in future examples, I'm probably going to skip this step because it is sort of, it's a bit long, and I'll allow you to do the same. Okay, so here we have limit as x approaches infinity of x plus the limit as x approaches infinity of 1, and then plus the limit as x approaches infinity of 1 over x. All right, and then in the denominator, we have the limit as x approaches infinity of 2 minus the limit as x approaches infinity of 3 over x. Now, let's examine each of these limits individually. This limit here of a constant is equal to the constant, right? That's something we learned before. The limit of a constant is always equal to that constant. This is still true for infinity as well. So that one's also equal to 2. The limit of 1 over x, as discussed in the last video, as x approaches infinity, that was 0. Now this, we could have written this as 3 times 1 over x. Okay. And so this, if the limit of the 1 over x is 0, we have 3 times 0. So this is also 0, right? And that just leaves this term right here. Now, as x approaches infinity, what does x approach? It approaches infinity, of course, right? So this is going to be infinity, positive infinity. Now, what the next thing I'm about to write is sort of technically not correct notation, but I am going to allow it in this instance. This is like infinity plus 1 plus 0 over 2 minus 0. This is technically not correct because I'm using infinity like a number, but this is at least a useful step along the way to arriving at the conclusion, which is the numerator is approaching positive infinity and the denominator is approaching positive 2. And if you take something which is getting really big and divide it by 2, it's still getting really big, just not quite as fast. Right? So the result here is still going to be positive infinity as the limit of this function. So there is the first example. Okay. Now, I do want to take this exact same function and examine a limit as x approaches negative infinity. I have that right over here. It's going to be very similar, right? So we'll apply exactly the same first few steps. I'll write this out just like I did last time. Okay, we're going to get x approaching negative infinity, x plus 1 plus 1 over x, 2 minus 3 over x. Now, this we're still going to get 1 and 2, even though x is approaching negative infinity. It doesn't matter if you go to the left or to the right, a constant function is constant in both directions. Also, it doesn't matter. Also, here and here, we're still going to get 0 because whether you're dividing by large positive numbers or large negative numbers, you're still going to be getting closer and closer to 0. So the fact that this is a negative infinity, it's not changing any of that. The only thing that's going to change is this term here where we get a negative infinity instead of a positive infinity. Like before, I'll write out the technically incorrect step where I use infinity like a number. Okay. Just because I think it's a useful, like I said, it's a useful step along the way. And clear here, I can see I have negative infinity divided by positive 2. So here it's clear that the values we're trending towards here are going to be negative values because the numerator is going to be negative and the denominator is going to be positive, right? So here we have negative infinity as a result. So whether you are approaching positive infinity or negative infinity matters in this situation. Another thing that could matter is the sign of the leading coefficients. In this case, the leading coefficients are 1 and 2, which are both positive. But if one of those leading coefficients were negative, that could change the sign of the result as well. So just bear that in mind. All right, so that basically covers our first situation where the numerator has a higher degree than the denominator. In each of these cases, we find the limit is infinite, plus or minus infinity. That will always be the case when the numerator's degree is larger than that of the denominator. Now, in the second case here, we'll look at an example where the degrees are equal. What's going to happen? Let's follow the same, you know, pick the same approach here. This time, what I want to multiply by is 1 over x squared. Like I said before, the best choice is the highest power of x that appears in the denominator in particular. So in this case, that's x squared. So distributing through here, we will get getting a bit of lag in my pen here. Here we go. We're going to get 5 plus 2 over x, the numerator, and we're going to get 2 minus 7 over x squared in the denominator. Now, what will happen as x approaches infinity? This is going to approach 0, as we've already discussed. This will approach 0, and then the constants will just approach themselves, as always. But the result here is 5 plus 0 over 2 minus 0, which is just 5 over 2. That was quite simple and satisfying. So you'll see what happened was the leading coefficients, which I'll put in orange again, these leading coefficients, I'll just put box around them in orange. 5 and 2, those turn out to be the only numbers that matter, right? Because when we divide by x squared, those are the only terms that end up being constant. And all other terms have powers of x in the denominator. And so all of the other terms will approach zero as x goes to infinity. And we just have those leading coefficients. So what we say is the limit in this scenario is the ratio of the leading coefficients. That will always happen when the numerator and denominator have equal degree. And so finally, we can move on to the last of the three cases, which is the one where the denominator has a higher power. I'm going to scoot this up a little bit. Oh, I know why it's not working. My apologies. I should have done this before I started recording. But you know, we roll with it. That's how we do. All right, there we are. So now, how about I didn't miss anything else? Everything's fine. It's fine. All right. All right, so we'll start the same way. We'll look at the highest power of x that appears in the denominator, divide by that. Don't panic, it's gonna be fine. I know you're probably looking at the numerator thinking, wait a minute, but we're gonna get something, what's gonna happen? Something different is gonna happen this time. So now what we'll find is in the numerator, yes, that first term is going to be 1 over x. Right? We don't have an x squared term up there, so we jump straight to the 1 over x, and then the next term is 1 over x squared. In the denominator, we do get a constant term, and this is good, we want this. So that first term, 2x squared divided by x squared is just 2, and then we have plus 1 over x, and then minus 6 over x squared. Okay, so this is nice, because the result is that in the denominator, we don't have 0. This first term approaches 2, the second two terms are gonna approach 0. So we'll have 2 plus 0 plus 0, great. In the numerator, 1 over x approaches 0, 1 over x squared approaches 0, and we have 0 minus 0. So that's fine. We end up with 0 divided by 2. This is fine. It's of course equal to 0, and that's the answer. The reason that I say it's best to divide by the highest power of x in the denominator in particular is to avoid the possibility of having the limit end up being zero in the denominator. Let's just avoid the division by zero situation because it's not quite as clear what's happening if we do that. So this method ensures that the denominator is not zero, but it's perfectly fine for the numerator. That just means that the answer is zero. And indeed, if the denominator's degree is larger than that of the numerator, the answer will always be. So here, these three examples basically are typical of rational functions. And that is summed up on this side by this sort of little theorem that I wrote. So here says, it basically sums up exactly what I've said. And it points out also that those limits tell us something about horizontal asymptotes. If the limit's plus or minus infinity, there's no horizontal asymptote. If the limit is zero, then y equals zero is a horizontal asymptote. And if we have the equal degrees scenario where those degrees are n, then the limit is going to be an over bn, where those are the leading coefficients. And y equals an over bn is also a horizontal asymptote. So that pretty much sums it up for this video.